Aloha, I'm Irminne Van Dyken, MD from Out of the Doldrums. Welcome back. Today, we're talking about something that might surprise you, creatine. Yep, the creatine supplement you have probably heard about in the context of gym performance or bodybuilders. But what if I told you that creatine may also play a role in brain health, not just in theory, but supported by early clinical research in Alzheimer's disease? And even more importantly, what if I told you that creatine is important for anyone who wants to protect or improve their cognitive function as they age? In this video, we're going to explore how the brain uses energy, why that's important in conditions like Alzheimer's disease, and how creatine might play a supporting role. The study I'm referring to was published in May 2025 in the journal Alzheimer's and Dementia, Translational Research and Clinical Interventions, and is titled Creatine Monohydrate Pilot in Alzheimer's, Feasibility, Brain Creatine, and Cognition. It's part of a registered clinical trial known as the CABA study, which stands for Creatine to Augment Bioenergetics in Alzheimer's Disease. The research was led by Dr. Matthew Taylor and his team at the University of Kansas Medical Center. So why would creatine be considered for something like Alzheimer's disease? Let's take a step back and look at brain energy metabolism. The brain is an energy-intensive organ. It only accounts for about 2% of body weight, but it uses roughly 20% of your body's total energy, most of it in the form of adenosine triphosphate, or ATP. In Alzheimer's, the brain doesn't just accumulate amyloid plaques and tau tangles, it has an energy issue. In a healthy brain, energy is generated primarily by mitochondrial metabolism of glucose. But in Alzheimer's disease, one of the earlier and more consistent findings is a state of impaired bioenergetics. Brain cells lose their ability to efficiently use glucose and generate ATP. And that's a problem because neurons are really energy intensive. They rely on continuous ATP production for everything from signal transmission to structural maintenance. This low energy state can be easily seen on PET scans and is considered a hallmark of the disease's early development. That energy shortfall creates a bottleneck for neurons. They need a constant uninterrupted supply of ATP to maintain their structure, fire signals, regulate calcium, and perform synaptic functions. When they can't keep up with those demands, function starts to break down. This is where creatine comes in. Creatine plays a critical role in stabilizing cellular energy. It helps regenerate ATP through the phosphocreatine system. More specifically, it donates phosphate groups to allow for more ATP to be made. This buffering helps maintain ATP availability in between bursts of mitochondrial activity. This is especially important in tissues that experience rapid energy shifts and changes in energy demand, tissues like muscle and the brain. Several studies have shown that brain creatine levels tend to be lower in individuals with Alzheimer's. So the hypothesis is pretty simple. By supplementing creatine, can we help the brain restore some of its lost energy buffering capacity and support cognitive performance? Stated another way, the theory is that increasing brain creatine stores may help buffer energy instability in Alzheimer's disease and support cognitive performance. In this pilot study, Dr. Taylor's team enrolled 20 adults with Alzheimer's disease. 65% of the participants were positive for at least one copy of the APOE4 allele, which is associated with a significantly increased risk of developing Alzheimer's disease and may also lead to an earlier onset of symptoms. Each participant received 20 grams of creatine monohydrate daily, broken down into two 10-gram doses twice daily for 8 weeks. This is considered a loading dose, and it's commonly used in athletic research. The main goals were to assess feasibility, measure changes in brain creatine levels using magnetic resonance spectroscopy, and look for any early signs of cognitive improvement. 19 out of the 20 participants completed the study with high compliance. The supplement was really well tolerated. There were no serious adverse effects, and participants experienced expected increases in blood creatine levels. Importantly, total brain creatine levels increased by an average of 11% after 8 weeks of supplementation. That confirms oral creatine is bioavailable in the brain and it's measurable using non-invasive MRSI imaging. The researchers also use the NIH toolbox to assess cognitive performance. This is a battery of cognitive tests that measures both crystallized intelligence, like vocabulary and general knowledge, and fluid cognition, such as memory, attention, and processing speed. While broad measures like the MMSE didn't change significantly over 8 weeks, the study found statistically significant improvements in several aspects of fluid cognition. Participants showed better performance on some tests called list sorting working memory, oral reading recognition, and a test called flanker inhibitory control and attention. These are all domains where brain energy buffering could theoretically make a huge difference. So what can we take away from all of this? Well, all in all, this was a small, open-label pilot study. There was only 20 participants, and there was no placebo group. And the duration was really short, only 8 weeks. So we can't do anything like claim it treats Alzheimer's. That would be inappropriate. But the study does show that number one, creatine is really well tolerated in this population. Number two, creatine increases brain creatine levels. And number three, it may influence specific domains of cognitive performance that rely on ATP stability. These results are promising enough that larger placebo-controlled trials are now being planned. And even though this research focused on Alzheimer's disease, it raises broader questions about how we support brain energy metabolism in general, especially as we age. So what about people who don't have Alzheimer's disease but are still interested in cognitive support? Well, creatine definitely may have a role there too. There's emerging research suggesting that it can help support working memory and cognitive function during periods of sleep deprivation, high cognitive load, or even aging. And because creatine is stored in both muscle and brain tissue, people with lower baseline levels to start with, such as vegetarians and older adults, may see the most benefit from supplementation. That being said, creatine isn't for everyone. And while I'm a doctor, I'm not your doctor, so check in with your doctor first. Here are a few reasons why someone may not want to take creatine. The first is kidney disease. You see, creatine is excreted through the kidneys. And although it's considered safe for healthy individuals, anyone with impaired kidney function should probably really think twice about taking it and should really consult their physician first. Second is creatine can have medication interactions, particularly with nephrotoxic drugs, so drugs that are metabolized by the kidneys, or diuretics. Third, there is a risk of dehydration. Creatine can increase water retention in muscle cells, so it can shift fluid balance slightly. Fourth, there is some GI upset seen, especially in high doses. So high doses of creatine, especially at the start, can cause bloating, cramping, or diarrhea in some individuals. And last, polypharmacy, where people are taking many different medications, or people who have complex medical conditions, those people should always check with a healthcare provider before adding any new supplement or medication. All in all, if you're interested in cognitive performance or healthy brain aging, creatine is a relatively low-cost, well-studied molecule that may offer benefit, particularly in conditions where brain energy metabolism is under stress. To wrap it all up, the study titled Creatine Monohydrate Pilot in Alzheimer's: Feasibility, Brain Creatine, and Cognition, conducted at the University of Kansas Medical Center and led by Dr. Matthew Taylor, provides early human evidence that creatine supplementation may support brain function by augmenting bioenergetics. We're gonna need larger and longer-term studies to know more, but this is a compelling area of research and one I'll continue following closely. So let's wrap it up. If this video brought up questions for you, or if you're curious about how to use creatine safely and effectively to support brain health, let me know in the comments below. I would love to hear your thoughts, your experiences, or what topics you want me to cover next. If you found this video helpful, please give it a thumbs up. It really helps others find this kind of science-based content. And if you haven't already, hit that subscribe button and turn on the notifications so you don't miss any future videos. I post pretty regularly on practical ways to support your health, brain, and body using real evidence and meaningful tools. Thank you so much for spending your time with me today. Cherish your health always, and aloha.